So first I want to thank Brian, who sent me these micro-fiche from HP. They are from 1984. It was Brian used to work for HP. He was an HP engineer and he was working in RF and sent me a whole bunch of parts too. And in some of those fish, there's something really precious, which is the cross-reference for components. So when you have HP components, like these are from my HP 98035 clock. These are the dead circuits we replaced in last episode. But they don't have regular numbers. At least this one has. It has a MOSTEC marking, but usually you only get the HP number. In this case, 1818-0469. Or in this one, it's a Motorola, but you have no idea what it is. It's an 1820-1592. And there have been cross references published, mostly by HP actually, but they are incomplete. One times out of three, there's a part that you can't find any reference to, and that's really a problem. And you might have spied my stash of HP components here in same thing. They would be categorized using their HP number. So everything has this 4 digits-4 digits number to it. Even a spring has it. So basically, this thing happens to be hopefully the Rosetta Stone for all the HP parts up to 1984. Plus, look what I got. I got a whole bunch of parts. Same thing, I have to find out what those are. Brian was an RF engineer, so here you see the little transistors, like the one that we're using my RF amplifier I tried to repair recently. And it turned out the amplifier worked, but if it hadn't, I didn't have the spare parts. Now I do. So thank you, Brian. So task number one is to read, or better, scan the microfiche. There are old microfiche readers aplenty on eBay, but not particularly cheap, nor did I want to encumber myself with a bulky reader that give pretty poor images, actually. There are some good quality ones that can scan a fish, but these are both huge in size and in price. So instead, I cobbled one together out of an add-on Star 207 microscope that they had sent me for free. So Adon Star sends them pretty liberally to YouTubers with no strings attached, in the hope that they will use them in their videos, which is actually what I'm just doing. So thank you very much, Adon Star. However, I am well endowed with real microscopes, and the Adon Star is microscope potato vision compared to the real thing. Obviously, it's a lot cheaper. So I normally work with the real microscope, and when it's time to take a photo for a video at limited resolution, I turn to the add-on star. That's how I took the failed quartz crystal pictures in a previous episode, for example. You can even have fun making pretty dye pictures if you're not too picky about the amount of noise and pixelation. This is obviously made to a price. But back to our microfiche here. So my first impulse was to put something white underneath and then put the microfiche on. And as you can tell, at first it doesn't look that good. But that's because you have the reflections from the direct lights that are in the microscope head. So if you turn that down, then all of a sudden it is much better. So that quick experiment showed that I had enough resolution, although just barely, and the correct magnification and field of view to not only view, but also take a readable picture of the microfiche. So it was now just a matter of getting nice uniform back illumination, and this old LCD screen from a Sony DVD player, which has the worst resolution ever. It was like 230x480. It was very easy to take apart. The LCD screen came out nicely. It was just glued on the periphery. So now, if I can just figure how to light up that puppy, I'm golden. And you can tell this is a cold cathode fluorescent light, CCFL. So that's before they had LEDs. So it's a few hundred volts on here. It's like one of the fluorescent tubes. You have first to strike it at 600 volts. And then once the discharge has started, you have to regulate it to 300. And that's what this little circuit does. But there are five leads out of there that went into the rest of the board. So what do they do? But I could get the number of the chips, and I got the head of that chip. It's a micro semi, and it's sure enough a CCFL controller. And they even had a schematics, which is not exactly what this is, but you can tell how this is supposed to be hooked up. It's supposed to control a bunch of high power transistors that go into a transformer and go into your light, and then you see that exactly on the chip. Right here is the controller. Here is probably an array of power transistors, and here is the transformer, and then it goes to the light. Well, I pretty quickly found that the ground here was over on the two first wires, and then I looked for the chip and power, and it was somewhere else. I think it was the orange one. So here you have the two grounds and the chip voltage. There's one pin that was hooked up to the brightness control pin, and then the last one was the red pin, and this went to the high power transistor. So I figured out this must be the voltage of the inverter. So they must have been able to power the power transistors at a different voltage than the chip itself. So what I did is that I tied those three together to plus 5 volt, and I tied those two to the ground. And I also checked that the enable of the pin, this was always enabled, because sometimes there is a disable to blank the screen, but that was actually done with the brightness on this. So give it 5 volt. Almost worked. Huh. It goes into protection mode. So when it does like this, it means it's trying to strike the tube, and then it went into some kind of protection. Okay, I just give it 5.2 volts instead of 5 volts. So my guess is that probably you want to get the CCFL voltage, or the power transistor section, a little bit more voltage than the chip. That's why they were separate. But we'll be happy with our 5.2 volts. So I needed just one more thing so the film would stay flat for getting a good focus across it. And I just took the front glass of two picture frames, and off we go. Microfiche scanner on the cheap. Okay, so now I think it's a pretty convincing microfiche reader and scanner, because of course you can take a picture of all that. And look, there is even an inversion setting on this, so I could make it black on white for OCR. And so you notice a little bit yellowish, but not to worry, going the wrong way. The minus makes it brighter, go figure, there you go. All right. And we can start to explore our part numbers. For example, let's try to look up those three parts. This is a transistor from Brian's collection, and it was not in the currently published equivalence tables. This is the quartz, the broken quartz. We actually know what it is, but I couldn't find any reference on the web, so maybe you'll find more details about this. And this is the ROM, has a MOSFET number on it, but I couldn't find any reference on it, so let's see if we can find a little bit more about it. First, the transistor, I didn't have to go very far to find it. It was on page 4, right here. Oh, there it is, right there. And this is why I realized the cross reference tables were incomplete, because they don't all have equivalents. But I would have enough data if I find this one in the circuit to replace it with something equivalent. So let's try the quartz now, and it was on a little further on fish 19. 0412, right there at the bottom. Oh, and in this case, it is completely blank. There is no information on it whatsoever. Totally blank except this 1 MHz. So no dice on that one. Let's try to do this one. We found out from the schematics that it was something similar to a 2716, but not exactly a 2716. And that one was on fiche 22. It should be over here between 0448 and 0477, and it's not. But the thing is that those are all mask ROMs, and they are all the same chip, completely the same chip. So there's no difference between all of those numbers except the program that's written on it, the mask that they are going to use. So they are all AMD AM9216 BDC. And here it is. This is the AMD 9216 2K by 8 read-only memory. Indeed, it's a mask ROM. And if you look at the selection pins, they can be ordered, and I suppose you change the mask for that, in either logic, in either positive select or negative select. So this is why ours had a reverse select on it. And off I went and started to look up all the new old parts I got from Brian, with many of them not being on the published cross-reference lists. In particular the juicy one, like the early JFETs or dual match transistors. I was able to identify 100% of them. There were some really neat ones, many of these older Fairchild metal can op amps, and this gated sense amplifier which will come in handy for core memory work. And even a vacuum tube. This is actually a microwave triode, good for up to 425 watts of pulse power at 5 GHz, new in the box. They managed to put a cathode, an anode, and a grid in a super small pencil-shaped tube, with the grid connection being the large disc in the middle. I'm not sure if we'll ever make this one work again, but it sure would be fun and with electroboom levels of high voltage. Anyhow, thank you to viewers, subscribers, and patrons for contributing such treasures to the channel, and to Add-on Star for sending me the microscope, which turned unexpectedly useful. Link in the doodly-doo. See you in the next episode!